Have you or a loved one recently been arrested for a serious crime?
Is your professional reputation at risk?
Aggressive representation from a qualified defense attorney can help you avoid conviction and keep your reputation untarnished.
Hi, I'm Charles McGill, and I'll fight for your rights. With extensive experience in successfully defending against a wide range of criminal offenses and high-profile cases, you can rest assured that you'll get the fair trial you deserve from McGill, Guzman, McGill. Call us at 559-255-3425 or visit us online at toplawyersfresno.com.
Hi, I'm John Malice. Welcome to this live edition of Connect With Me on the showroom floor at Ventura TV on this day. Glad you're here on a Thursday morning. We're talking about the Fresno County Search and Rescue Team. A very complex show today. Well, kind of. It's complex in the way that, well, what do they exactly do? Is it really simple or is it complex? We'll talk about it. 436 MeTV Option 11. Three guests in the studio today. It should be an exciting show. Can't wait. Back in a moment. Back here on the program here on a Thursday morning on Connect With Me on the showroom floor at Ventura TV, of course. And a couple of programming notes before we get into this very exciting program here today with the search and rescue team. Tomorrow, Henry Perea is going to be in the studio to talk about his run for mayor of the city of Fresno. So a lot of questions will be directed towards him in terms of city politics, the Fresno Police Department, Fresno Fire Department. And also, they're breaking ground on the Fulton Mall, so we'll talk to him about that. And also, next week, we'll have Gabriel Dillard on, and also a new boxing gym that just opened up. And also, we're going to try to negotiate to try to get a guest here on the program who works for Fox News to talk about the presidential race. His name is John Gibson, and so he works for Fox News Radio. He'll break it all down. As you know, Mitt Romney came out today and really talked it up, trying to spank and slap down Donald Trump and trying to persuade voters not to vote for him. So we'll talk about that in the coming days here on the program. In the meantime, you're watching us on Comcast Channel 375 as usual. It's called Xfinity, but if you don't have Comcast cable at home, as you know by now, it's 43.6 and 13.1 over-the-air broadcast if you have a digital antenna. And as you well know, we're on from 10 to 11 o'clock in the morning. If you can't stay here for the entire hour, you can watch the replay at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, 13.6 U2, and 8 o'clock tonight on 4.6 Biz TV. So just a little more than a month ago, the Fresno County Search and Rescue Team was honored for finding a woman that was stuck in the Sierra National Forest. She was stuck there for 9 days. Sheriff Margaret Mims presided over that ceremony in downtown Fresno. I want to roll the videotape and show you exactly what I'm talking about, my friends. The search and rescue team has been around for many years, and their primary function is to search, rescue, and recover people who are either lost, injured, or killed. And let me tell you, my friends, these members are on call 24 hours a day, and they operate in all kinds of conditions, including snow, cold, blizzards, if necessary, conditions that most of us could not handle. They are highly trained to survive and be self-sufficient for days at a time in the wilderness, in the water, in the mountains, all the while looking for rescuing someone who has either been hurt or killed. They have so many skills to master out there, and one of those is knowing how to ride a snowmobile, as you see right here, and how to use a rope to rescue someone. Last year, 62-year-old Mayuki Harwood survived in the wild for 9 days until the search and rescue team found her 19 miles east of Courtright Reservoir. The Orangevale woman had been backpacking with members of the Sierra Club on Black Cap Mountain when she left the group to go back to her campsite. But she fell off a cliff, landed on both legs, but couldn't stand up and walk. She crawled down to a nearby running water and lived on that water for 9 days. A little ahead of yourself there, my friends. Search and rescue team searched for days and flew in The Black Hawk helicopter, that's actually the Chinook.
Sorry.
So there's the Black Hawk helicopter. I guess you're not following me too well in this monologue, are you? Okay, well, let's just go to the guest. Live in our studio right now is Kathy Curtis of the Fresno County Search and Rescue Team. She knows this story inside out. Maybe we can get this mess straightened out in the next segment after the break. Back in just a moment.
When you like Ventura TV Appliance on Facebook, it's nice. But when you love the KitchenAid appliances we deliver, it's even better. Our website is cool, and it's a good place to start. But you really should touch the merchandise before you buy. Save big with KitchenAid. Right now, get up to a $1,000 prepaid MasterCard when you purchase select KitchenAid appliances. Get the best selection, price, and service in town without waiting. Come in to Ventura TV Appliance and touch the merchandise today.
Have you or a loved one recently been arrested for a serious crime?
Is your professional reputation at risk?
Aggressive representation from a qualified defense attorney can help you avoid conviction and keep your reputation untarnished.
Hi, I'm Charles McGill, and I'll fight for your rights. With extensive experience in successfully defending against a wide range of criminal offenses and high-profile cases, you can rest assured that you'll get the fair trial you deserve from McGill Guzman McGill. Call us at 559-255-3425 or visit us online at toplawyersfresno.com.
Sorry about that monologue, folks, but the problem is that never finished telling the story about Mayuki. So Kathy Curtis is here. Maybe you can help explain what happened, because we got all confused and discombobulated with those pictures. I was trying to tell the story about how you guys rescued her. So put up anything you want on the screen here and you can tell the story, Kathy.
Sure, absolutely. In the latter part of August of 2015, the Fresno County Sheriff's Office received the report of Mayuki Harwood as being missing in the area that you described a little bit ago.
Right.
In very eastern Fresno County, up in the very high Sierras. And immediately after we received that report, the search and rescue team was activated to go and look for her. It wound up being, for us, over an 11-day mission.
Right.
And
she was finally found on August the 29th when I was trying to get through the story, but I gave up on it because the picture didn't match what I was saying. So what I was trying to say is that she was down in this like little ravine area right by the water.
Yes, when she was located, that's exactly
where
she was.
Yeah, and she blew her whistle, and for days on end, she was blowing her whistle, and she saw the helicopters up above, and they couldn't see her because of the rough fire. The smoke from the rough fire, right?
Yeah, a lot of things contributed to this, but the rough fire really hindered our efforts right from the beginning, because it prevented us from being able to fly a lot of helicopters in to search for her as we normally would. And what helicopters also do for us on these sorts of searches is they allow us to insert searchers. So we couldn't get a large number of bodies in on a regular basis because of the fire.
Right. She was blowing her whistle, and finally on August the 29th, somebody heard her, because they were somebody was walking by looking for her, and they finally heard her cries for help with that whistle, right?
Yeah, there was a team that was assigned to search that area, and shortly after they started their search assignment for that day, they heard her whistle.
Yeah. Yeah, maybe if we can call it up. We have 1,001 pictures here, so let's try to pull up the one of her broken leg. She's got her legs out. That's an interesting photo right there. Explain what kind of injuries that she had, Kathy, because you know this case inside out.
Yeah, what we ultimately found had happened with Mayuki is that she had become separated from her group that she was hiking with, and her intention, we didn't know it until after she was located, but her initial intention had been to hike back to camp by herself.
Yeah.
On her way back to camp, she became lost. She reoriented herself, figured out exactly where she was, and as she headed back towards camp, she took a fall. And when she fell off of some rocks. She landed feet first, and it caused broken bones in both legs.
Yeah, yeah. So both of those legs were broken, huh?
Different
Not
parts of them.
Different parts
yeah.
were broken,
yeah.
a part of her leg. What picture were we looking at there? Was that the area where she was stranded?
Yes.
That was the area that was near where she had taken the initial fall. And that was an area that she actually had to make her way through with her injuries in order to get herself to water.
Okay. Interesting. And how did she survive out there for 9 days?
She had an amazing will to survive. She had an incredible attitude of self-perseverance, really. Mm-hmm. And what she really did physically to help herself was she got herself to water. And she stayed at the place where she had fallen and become injured for 2 nights. And then on that third day, she decided that if she was going to do anything to help herself, she needed to get to water.
So she just crawled down there, right?
I can't even say that it was crawled. She more like drug. She dragged herself. Yeah.
Pretty much down by the water. Now, she had a water bottle that had a filter on it?
Correct.
Okay. And that helped filter the water so it became drinkable, I guess.
Yes.
And so did she do everything right? Obviously, I guess she did because she's alive today. But did she do everything by the book, everything that you tell people to do when they go hiking?
Well, you know, clearly she made a couple of mistakes initially that contributed to this.
She slipped and fell off a cliff.
Yeah,
right?
And that was exactly. And that's
That can happen to anybody,
absolutely.
Right?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
That totally wasn't her fault.
Right. But after those incidents and after she found herself incapacitated and stranded, absolutely, she did a lot of things that helped her stay alive until we could find her.
Yeah, pretty amazing.
And, you know, one of the things in talking to her afterwards that we got from her was her commitment to helping herself. She refused to lie there and just completely be helpless. Even though she had significant injuries, she was absolutely committed to doing whatever she could to help us find her.
Yeah. Talking to Kathy Curtis, Fresno County Sheriff's Rescue Team, Search and Rescue Team. We'll be back in just a moment here on Connect With Me.
Revan is now on KVHF channel 4.4. Not sure what you're watching? Want to see what's coming up next? Or just want to browse what's on without the hassle of flipping channels? Your wish has come true. Now you can view schedules for all the digital TV channels available in the Central Valley. Get local weather updates and forecasts, and listen to nationally syndicated Biz Talk Radio, all on KVHF 4.1. Rescan your TV now, then tune in to digital channel 4.1 to start enjoying the all-new TV guide.
Back here on the program, Connect With Me on MeTV Fresno. Charles Chuck McGill is our sponsor today. Kathy Curtis is here from the Fresno County Search and Rescue Team. Let's put up on the screen some of the safety tips that you, and I will get into the Search and Rescue Team, but since we talked about the Harwood story that took place last year, these are some of the safety tips. You can look at them on the screen for yourself, Kathy, and just check out and see, you know, what you're asking people to do if they go up into the mountains, whether it be summer or winter. Go ahead and comment on what you're looking at there.
Yeah, absolutely. Everything that you're seeing on the screen right now are bare minimum items that we carry with us
when we're working.
And also things that we recommend that everybody who's up in the mountains keep with them just in case of an emergency.
Right, right. And you can see that there. Now, you know, for those of you who cannot see the screen, let's go back to the last one or the first one that you put up there. And that is, you know, I'll just read them off for the people who cannot see the screen, because some people, you know, we have one viewer who cannot see the screen. She has some eyesight problems. So that waterproof means of starting a fire. You have a jacket, a water purification system, meaning what?
Some means of taking the impurities and the contaminants in the water out so that it's drinkable.
Okay. Plastic survival blanket, tarp, etc. for shelter. A whistle, which helped Harwood in her case because they tracked her down when she blew the whistle. You've got to have a map and compass. Go to the next one. Are all of these just common sense items that you need to take with you?
Yes.
Pretty much?
Yes.
It's pretty common sense, right?
Yeah.
Now, I never would have thought about having a mirror. A mirror comes in handy if you want to signal, you know, that you're down below. I never would have thought of that.
For the aircraft.
Yeah. Yeah, interesting. And it's still hard to see that through the smoke, though. You can't see that through the smoke if there was a fire, though.
Right.
Like in the Harwood case, right?
Right.
Yeah. So, did she have a mirror with her? Did Harwood have a mirror with her?
I don't think that she did.
And it may not have helped even if she'd had one, right, because of the thick smoke?
Right, and because of the thick smoke, we did not have a lot of aircraft flying.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. You didn't. And that's still one of the most amazing stories, how she survived, you know, all those days. Caller, you're on the air. Go ahead.
Kathy, let me ask you a question. I've been kind of interested in the rescue mission that you are involved in. Let's say in the snow, skiers, okay, and there was a avalanche and it covered them up, you know, and let's say by the time you found out, it's been an hour passed by, okay? Now, do you use dogs for that case to sniff out, you know, where they could be? And how long can a person live covered up in the snow like that? Is there a time limit? Because I really don't know, you know, if you get covered with all that snow, especially when you're skiing and an avalanche comes by and it buries you, is there a certain time that you have to get to them before they, you know, could die, you know? So that's my question to you.
Well, I'll answer the second part of that as really it kind of depends. It depends on a lot of things. It depends on the environment. It depends on whether or not the person who was caught up in the avalanche struck any objects, any trees, any rocks, suffered some trauma as a result of the avalanche. And also, it depends on the amount of snow. Generally speaking, you know, as time goes on, survivability will, you know, the likelihood of it decreases, but that it's going to be that way with any sort of a catastrophic incident like that. However, there are a lot of times in which people have survived in the snow, even buried in the snow, because one of the most important things outside of the trauma that they might have suffered is going to be the oxygen. So if they are able to have a pocket of air to breathe, a lot of times that extends that period of time for them.
And, you know, the higher that you go in the mountains, you have less oxygen, too, to deal with. Mm-hmm. And that becomes a problem.
Sure.
So what do you suggest people do if they go up into the snow and let's say they're hiking or they're skiing or this or that, and they go off the trail and all of a sudden they say, oh my God, you know, I lost my bearings. I'm not sure exactly where I am. Obviously, you know, we put up the safety tips. You have a compass. You should have a compass with you when you ski. What are some of the other things that maybe you ought to have in your pocket while you're skiing? Give us an idea.
Well, it's a good idea to keep anything with you that you're going to need in order to survive yourself until we can catch up to you.
But how much can you carry if you're just out on a skiing mission? You're just, even if you're hiking in the snow, how much can you possibly carry with you, especially if you're going down a hill?
Well, even at minimum, you know, map and compass. And most compasses come with a mirror on them.
Okay.
So the right there, you've kind of covered two objects in one. You've got the mirror to signal to the aircraft, and the whistles a lot of times also come attached to the compasses. We attach ours actually to the compasses. So we've got all three items right there compartmentalized. But one of the biggest things that will help us if somebody goes missing, and, you know, in the example like you're talking about, is to really just kind of stop and stay put. Because a lot of times people think that they reorient themselves and head off in the wrong direction, and they're actually moving farther away from us.
If you get lost in the snow and it's really cold, I've thought about this. One of the things that Harwood survived on, and the only thing she survived on for 9 days, was water. Mm-hmm. That was it. Had it not been for that creek down there, that water, she would have been dead, no question about it. So if you get caught in a mountain and you've slipped, nobody knows where you are, you've been skiing all day, can you eat the snow to survive?
You can. It's water. It's water-based. You know, we like to suggest taking some sort of a stove or a way to warm it and melt it, but
Is it clean? Is it sanitary enough to, you know, I guess at that point you're not worried about that, right?
At that point, I would not be worried about it.
But you can do that.
You can do that.
Okay.
It's better to melt it, but you can just eat it.
Yeah, because, I mean, when a person is skiing, you can't be carrying water bottles with you. Water is heavy. Mm-hmm. There's only so much that you can carry on your body with you at the same time. Am I right?
You're right. Most people that tend to go out do kind of like we do, though, and carry small backpacks.
Even when you're skiing?
Sure. Cross-country skiing, we would.
Cross-country, yeah.
Not downhill skiing,
downhill
but then you're in a
skiing,
ski resort.
Yeah. But if you're downhill skiing, more than likely you're not going to get lost. But then, you know, there's always that chance, that possibility, too. If you go off the trail, you go off on your own, you get separated from whatever group that you're in, like Harwood did. She decided to separate herself and go back to the campsite from the group that she was in. Was that a mistake?
It's not something that we would recommend.
Absolutely.
One of the first things we recommend is to travel in groups or at minimum in pairs.
Yeah. Okay, Kathy Curtis is here from the Fresno County Search and Rescue Team. Glad that she is here. We're going to come back and talk about what the Search and Rescue Team is all about and what her day-to-day duties are on the team. Back after this, 436-ME-TV, Option 11, in just a moment.
When you're looking for Whirlpool innovation and quality, who has the answers, the selection, the price? Ventura TV Appliance. With billions in nationwide appliance buying power, more than Home Depot and Best Buy combined, we'll help you save. Our low prices on ENERGY STAR qualified Whirlpool appliances save you energy and money, and pay no interest on select models when paid in full within 12 months. Ventura TV Appliance, serving you since 1951.
Have you or a loved one recently been arrested for a serious crime?
Is your professional reputation at risk?
Aggressive representation from a qualified defense attorney can help you avoid conviction and keep your reputation untarnished.
Hi, I'm Charles McGill, and I'll fight for your rights. With extensive experience in successfully defending against a wide range of criminal offenses and high-profile cases, you can rest assured that you'll get the fair trial you deserve from McGill Guzman McGill. Call us at 559-255-3425 or visit us online at toplawyersfresno.com.
Back here on the show with Kathy Curtis, Fresno County Search and Rescue Team. How long have you been on the Search and Rescue Team?
Off and on for a total of about 15 years.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And explain it. I mean, this thing dates back how many years now, this Fresno County Rescue Team, Fresno County Search and Rescue Team?
The Search and Rescue Team for Fresno County dates back a number of decades, but one of the things that's mandated in the government code is for sheriff's offices to do search and rescue. So even before we had an actual search and rescue team, as we know it now, deputy sheriffs were searching for people since its inception and rescuing people because that was one of their functions of county sheriff's offices.
So is this unit, the search and rescue team, I know you have four different teams on here. You have the Mountaineer Unit Team, the Mounted Posse Team, the Jeep Rescue Unit Team, the Air Squadron Team. Are all these teams, is the unit overall, is it funded by Fresno County and the Fresno County Sheriff's Office, or is it a on a volunteer basis? What is it?
It's both. It's a combination of both. We have all of those volunteer teams that you just mentioned, and they're primarily self-funded. They provide...
They are? Really?
They are. They are volunteer units. They provide their own training, their own equipment, and they volunteer those services under our umbrella of search and rescue.
Mm-hmm.
In addition to that, now we also have deputy sheriffs and sworn personnel that then the county provides.
Mm-hmm. So the Fresno County Sheriff's Department is not involved financially with any of the teams, or
very little. They primarily fund themselves.
They fund themselves.
Yeah.
What is the primary function of the team? How many members? What do you guys do on a day in and day out basis? Explain that part.
Well, as far as the sworn team members, this is a collateral duty for us. So there's 19 different team members, myself being one of them. There's four sergeants and 14 deputy sheriffs.
Right.
We all work in different parts of the county in different assignments. And then when a search and rescue mission comes up, then we leave our primary assignments and go work on the search or the rescue or whatever it is. Now, the volunteers, of course, You know, they come from all walks of life, all different occupations, all different backgrounds.
I could be a volunteer.
You could.
For example, if I wanted to be, if I'm in, you know, good enough shape, I guess. Talk about the training. What kind of training do you guys go through for, you know, this type of assignment?
Oh, there's a lot of different training, really varied things that we have to be able to make sure that our team members are capable of doing. And it's everything from swift water rescue and swimming type of things to land navigation, map and compass work, technical rope work, wide variety of stuff.
And where does this training take place?
All over the place. We conduct monthly trainings. A lot of them take place in the Sierra Nevada mountains. Because that's,
really?
Yeah.
So you go up there for days at a time to train?
We do.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Twice a year we conduct two-day trainings. So we'll be up there for 2 days and overnight twice a year.
Okay. And so you learn how to ride a snowmobile if you don't know how to ride one.
Yeah, we learn, snowmobile, cross-country skiing, snowshoeing. We actually have a snowcat, so we make sure that everybody knows how to operate the snowcat properly. And every piece of equipment imaginable, we have to make sure that everybody's trained in.
And you learn how to use a rope, too, to try to rescue somebody, either on the mm-hmm. side of a mountain or a cliff mm-hmm. or whatever, right?
Right.
And how does that work?
Well, the rope rescue course is actually a 40-hour certification that every person has to go through.
But do you go through, I mean, is it, do you actually have a person like hanging on the edge of a cliff or you can rescue so you can practice these things or
absolutely.
How does it work?
Do? Yeah, we do. It's always one of us because it's staged,
right.
It's set up. But yeah, we have to.
It's a staged process, right?
Right. Okay. We have to practice it as if it were going to be in real life. Yeah.
And you practice going underwater.
We do.
Rescue someone underwater.
Yep.
Or who is on the verge of drowning.
Mm-hmm.
So the training is quite extensive then.
It is.
Yeah, so you got to be in good shape.
Mm-hmm.
How many days do you stay up there?
For training?
For training at a time.
We train monthly for just 1 day. And then twice a year, again, we train for the 2 days.
Yeah. Okay, some of the things that I took off, I think I found some of this stuff on the website, but some of it you sent to me. So talk about some of the stuff. If you're out there boating or you're swimming, what's the number one rule in your opinion?
Know how to swim.
What? Besides that, I'm talking about safety.
And
what's the number one safety tip? If you're out there swimming and boating, because, you know, the summer's coming up, it's just around the corner. It's only a few months away. So what kind of tips would you offer people out there watching?
For boating, we always make sure that people know to have a life jacket. And we also point out that alcohol and swimming and boating don't mix.
Yeah. Should you be wearing that life jacket on the boat while you're boating?
Yes.
You should be at all times?
Yeah.
In case?
In case of an accident or an incident or something that you're not prepared for.
Yeah. And what, by the way, how many members on your team altogether?
Altogether, including our volunteer units, the numbers are going to fluctuate between about 150 and 200.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's amazing. Okay. So, and what are some of the waterways that you guys patrol?
We've got two rivers that flow through Fresno County. We've got the San Joaquin River and the Kings River.
Okay.
And then some of the major lakes, of course, are the big ones, such as Pine Flat Reservoir, Shaver Lake, Huntington Lake. And then we've got the higher elevation ones, too, like Courtright, Wishon, Redinger's a smaller one.
Millerton, too?
Off to the side. Millerton is in the county, but it is actually the jurisdiction of state parks.
Okay. So you're not really out there then?
No.
Okay, so the ones that you just mentioned are where you... Okay, so, you know, hiking is a huge thing with a lot of people
mm-hmm.
in Fresno County, as you know. And Fresno County is what, about 2,000 square miles?
6,000.
Is it 6,000?
Yeah.
Okay, wow.
Yeah.
So you have to cover that vast area mm-hmm. here in Fresno County. You know how many people hike in this area. Mm-hmm. It's a very popular sport. They go up to Yosemite, they go here, they go there. What's the number one rule in hiking? What do you do? To stay safe.
Make sure that somebody knows what your plans are. Leave an itinerary with somebody and a very clear plan as to what to do if you don't arrive back home or wherever it is that you're supposed to arrive.
Should you always tell somebody when you're arriving? What if you don't have an arrival date? What if it's open-ended and you're going out and you're Well, I don't know when I'm exactly coming back.
Well, that actually really does happen, John. That really does happen that way. And then what happens is...
Not a good idea, though, huh?
It's not, and it makes it difficult, because then the friends and family members don't know what time to report you missing.
Yeah. What about staying on the trail?
Staying on the trail is extremely important also. Makes it much easier for us to catch up to you, because we don't know otherwise at what point you would leave the trail and for what reason.
What are some of the biggest mistakes that people make when they hike that you've seen over the course of 15 years?
Well,
hang on, caller.
We've seen people that have gone out hiking alone and then become injured. And once they become injured without there being somebody else with them, then there's no way to report that injury or to get help. So a lot of so hiking alone is probably one of the bigger ones.
And people have to remember that, cell phones for the most part don't work up there in the mountains, do they?
Correct.
So you got to keep that in mind. Caller, you're on the air. Go ahead with Kathy Pierce.
Yeah, on that note,
Kathy Curtis.
I'm a backcountry skier and I use GPS. And there's been many times where I've not set my coordinates right and I ended up somewhere else. But my question is that, do you have any avalanche dogs working for you right now? I mean, because I race St. Bernards, and that's when I do my backcountry skiing. I train them for avalanche rescue, and I didn't know. I'm up here in Small Valley area.
We do have search dogs here in Fresno County that we utilize, and we also draw from a bigger resource pool of search dogs throughout California, and there are avalanche dogs that are utilized throughout California.
Interesting.
Well, I was just thinking if I could join, maybe. I'll get it. If you wanted one locally, that I have like two or three. Now I only have two.
All right.
Well, for anybody who is interested in volunteering with search and rescue, the website to go to would be www.fresnosar.org.
Yeah. Okay, caller, thank you very much.
You.
By the way, before we go to break, we're going to bring up another guest. We have two other guests from the Fresno County Search and Rescue Team here on the program today. Explain the search and rescue dogs. They're a very important part of your team. And what do you have them do and how do you train them?
Well, I can't speak a whole lot to the training of them because I am not a handler of one of the dogs, but I can tell you what we use them for.
Okay.
The search and rescue dogs are actually a pretty neat tool for us, and it's a completely different way of searching for our people. And the dogs can be trained to search for folks in two different ways. They can be either what we call the area search dogs that just search for scents of a human in the area,
right.
Or they're also the trailing dogs that will search for a specific scent. And we use both of those.
So those are two different specific qualities that those dogs have, right? There's one dog that you have that searches an area, right?
Mm-hmm. Right.
And one dog that searches specifically for a person?
A specific person.
A specific person.
Right.
With the smell of a shirt or a pair of pants or a sweater or something like that, the dog can go after that scent, right?
Correct.
Okay. And how valuable are those dogs to you?
They're very, very, very valuable because this is something that humans can't do.
Yeah.
So it's another tool for us.
Yeah. All right, Kathy Curtis from the Fresno County Search and Rescue Team. You've been on the team 15 years and counting, right?
That's right.
No plans on retiring, I hope.
That's correct.
All right. Thank you for your time today. I really appreciate it.
Thank you, John.
Thank you for the insight.
Thank you.
And stay safe out there.
Thanks.
All right. Two other guests coming up here on the program, 436 MeTV Option 11. Glad you're with us. Charles Chuck McGill is our sponsor today.
After God created the world, he made man and woman. Then, to keep the whole thing from collapsing, he invented humor.
Sub, a perfect reason to rejoice. A distinctly positioned channel in the crowded Hindi general entertainment channel space. It is India's only family comedy entertainment channel with a core brand promise of Asli Maza Sabke Saath Aata Hai.
Dekh raha hu.
Which means celebrate the joy of being together. Taking humor as a universal language, the shows on Sub are light-hearted and make up for an enjoyable family viewing experience. Indeed.
Asli maza.
Sabka saath aata hai.
Ab to sabko pata hai yaar.
Zob TV.
Have you or a loved one recently been arrested for a serious crime?
Is your professional reputation at risk?
Aggressive representation from a qualified defense attorney can help you avoid conviction and keep your reputation untarnished.
Hi, I'm Charles McGill, and I'll fight for your rights. With extensive experience in successfully defending against a wide range of criminal offenses and high-profile cases, you can rest assured that you'll get the fair trial you deserve from McGill Guzman McGill. Call us at 559-255-3425 or visit us online at toplawyersfresno.com.
The new Frigidaire Professional line at Ventura TV Video Appliance. Enjoy generous-sized cooktops and sauté or simmer with ease, while true convection ovens offer even baking and juicy roasting perfection. Foods stay their freshest in spacious refrigerators with convenient controls and clear filtered ice and water. Easy-to-clean surfaces reduce fingerprints, and the quietest of dishwashers makes cleanup a snap. The new Frigidaire Professional line at Ventura TV Video Appliance. You can find movies on Over the Air Channel 13.3. Movies. Our name says it all.
When you're looking for KitchenAid innovation and quality, who has the answers, the selection, the price? Ventura TV Appliance. With billions in nationwide appliance buying power, more than Home Depot and Best Buy combined, we'll help you save. Our low prices on ENERGY STAR qualified KitchenAid appliances save you energy and money, and pay no interest on select models when paid in full within 12 months. Ventura TV Appliance, serving you since 1951.
Okay, back here on the program today, here talking about the Fresno County Search and Rescue Team. And now time to welcome in Greg Muskelin and Jared McCormick. And Jared is from the Search and Rescue Team. He is a sergeant. And also, Greg is a volunteer mountaineer, are you not?
Yes, sir.
All right. So how long have you been on the team, Greg?
I've been on the team for 5 years.
Wow. And how about you, Jared?
A little over 10.
A little over 10. Well, yeah. Kathy has a little seniority over
she
you.
Does.
So
she's my boss.
She's your boss. All right. And so let's talk about, since you're wearing all the bright orange outfits, and they look terrific, by the way, guys. Kathy was wearing it, too. What suggestions do you have? Because in the Harwood case, Miyuki, who was up there for 9 days, she wasn't wearing a bright color like orange or red or green. Do you suggest everyone who goes up there wears bright colors like this? And if so, why?
Well, bright colors are much easier to be seen from the air when there's vehicles up in the air, airplanes, that type of thing, looking for us. And easier for the ground searchers to spot you from far off. We don't have to be as close and able to detect the person.
Right. And Jared, you were part of that search and rescue team looking for Harwood all of those days, right? Explain what that experience was like and what your job was.
Well, from my standpoint, I wasn't so much out in the field looking for her. I was more from the management aspect. So I was back at the command post.
What were you doing? What was your primary duty?
Planning to make sure that we get certain areas that get covered and looked into by all the resources that were available to us, making sure that we had these resources, trying to figure out where to put them. Know that they were out there looking for clues that would report back to us, that we have this large group of people and how you manage getting to her. So that was our ultimate goal, just trying to plan there at the command post.
Were you getting frustrating after day 3, 4, 5, 6, 7?
You know, obviously you want, when you get out there and you start looking, you've got all these people that are trying their best to find her, and you're not able to do so immediately, 2-3 days, you become frustrated. But there's not much quit in us, and I know that there's not much quit in all the volunteers that are also out there. So there was no, we weren't going to give up. So, but it was frustrating. You know, 9 days is a long time to look for somebody.
You know, here's the thing about this, and Greg, maybe you can talk a little bit about this since you're a volunteer, part of the Mountaineer Unit, and there are four units here: the Mountaineer Unit, the Mounted Posse, the Jeep Rescue Unit, and the Air Squadron. You know, after 6 or 7 or 8 or even the 9th day before she was found, you know, you would have thought, my God, this woman has got it. I mean, how could she have survived? We haven't found her. At what point, as a planner, the way that you were, Jared, maybe you can start this, do you say to yourself, when do we throw in the towel, or do we?
I think there's a lot of variables to consider. I mean, the weather, for one. You know, we had good weather. Granted, there was smoke everywhere, so it made it difficult to breathe, but
right,
we weren't dealing with, you know, freezing temperatures. We knew that she was probably going to be alive in that sense, so that was one thing that was beneficial to us. We didn't know that she had fallen. There's a potential that she could have been just lost. We didn't know that the supplies that she had with her, we didn't know if she had 3 days worth of food or no food. So it, a lot of those things come into play when it making determination. So it's really not known, but it's just hard to say.
You don't ever want to give up on human life. That's not what I'm suggesting. But at what point does reality set in, and you know, that you don't become in, you know, in this state of mind where you're in denial? Maybe you can answer that, Greg.
Well, at the time you're focused
on... Hang on, caller.
At the time you're focused on the mission, you have a particular area that you need to search, and the presumption is that you're going to find this missing person, and that's what keeps us moving forward and moving forward on our job.
Were you even conscious of how many days it had been at the time?
Yes, myself, my team, we were on scene the very beginning of the search. We were in the field for 3 days. There were various volunteer mountaineers that were rotated in and out over the entire course of this event.
Yeah. And so what was your experience like during that time?
My experience, our initial mission was to carry a bunch of repeater electronic equipment to help the communications with the radios, because the command post was quite far from where the search area was. So our team was tasked with getting a bunch of radio equipment to the top of a ridge, setting it up so that teams could continue communicating. Then after that, we were tasked with searching some other lakes in the area that were right around the perimeter of the search area. And we were at the south end of the search area, so it was very smoky where we were, very close to the ridge fire.
And we're going to get to the call in a minute here, but at what point do you say, you know what, we've been over this area once, twice, let's go over it again. Do you do that?
That happens often. In fact, we do that for a reason, so that we can have a higher probability to say, hey, she's not in this area. We've put hours of... countless hours of searching into a specific area that we think we might find her, and if she's not there after doing that, it gives us the ability to move on to a different location.
Yeah. I mean, you turn over every leaf, you turn over every rock. I mean, that's a cliche, but it's true, right?
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
It's true.
Under every log, behind every boulder, you never know where you might find the person.
Yeah. Caller, go ahead. You're on the air.
Yes, I heard you talking about various branches of the search and rescue. Don't they have a dive team too, a dedicated dive team that goes out on some of the, I don't know.
Can barely hear you. Can you speak up?
I'm saying, don't they also have a dive squad, a squad of divers that's dedicated for water rescue?
Yeah, go ahead.
Absolutely. We do have a team of sheriff's dive team. They don't work so much on our search and rescue team, but if necessary, we can call them as another resource to look into a body of water that we might have interest in. And they specialize in a lot of, you know, dive aspects that we as a search and rescue don't do. We're more above water. We're a little more
right,
dealing with stuff on the land. But if somebody we believe that may have been drowned, then we would call on our dive team, yeah.
Right. Greg, talk about, and I touched on this with Kathy just briefly, and that is... the very valuable dogs that you have available to you in this search and rescue effort with anyone. Talk about how valuable they are, and and how they're trained and what you do to utilize them.
I can't really speak to the training. I'm not a dog handler myself, but as far as utilization, we have about 5 or 6 members on our team who are also proficient dog handlers and have excellent dogs. They drastically cut down the time that's necessary to potentially find the person because, like Lieutenant Curtis said, the dogs have this keen sense of smell. They can lock onto the trail and perhaps send us in a specific direction that we might not have otherwise chosen to begin with. It cuts down the time frame quite a bit.
Yeah, it does. And it helps, you know, that a dog can go into certain areas that maybe a human being can't go into. Is that true?
Sure.
For example?
If there was a small narrow spot between some rocks or under some logs, the dog can quickly follow that trail and determine whether or not that's something that we should spend more time searching.
Yeah, and there's a piece of videotape that I do want to show we haven't shown yet, and it shows us some snow digging, and you guys are out there digging in the snow, and what are you doing here? You're creating what?
I do know that oftentimes we use those shovels to build like shelter. We can make like a snow cave
or a trench. And I think that's what's going on here. I think you're building a snow cave.
Yeah, it looks like they're putting together a pile of snow so that you can carve out the interior.
Hang on, caller. And what is the benefit of this?
To get out of the weather, get out of the elements. And it's basically a little hut that you can sleep in.
So this is what you guys use to stay out there for days at a time looking for someone, right?
We might make this like a little spike camp command area where we're going to know this, we're going to bed down, and during the day we'll go out and look into, you know, areas and come back and stay the night inside these snow caves.
Yeah, it's amazing. How long does it take to dig one of those out like that?
It's going to take probably about an hour and a half, 2 hours to build a decent one, something that's going to get to be big enough for just maybe 2 or 3 people.
Yeah. Yeah, and there you are building the fire there. And so how many, depending on how big that little hut or cave is, how many people can you get in there at a time? Maybe 2 at the most?
Generally, they're usually about 2.
About
sleep
2
to 3 comfortably.
Yeah, 2 to 3 comfortably. And so let's take the caller here before we go to break. Go ahead, caller.
Hello. Mute that thing for the mute. Okay, I just called to say thank you for the great work that you do. I think that it's marvelous to have people like you and have programs like this that go out and help people. And I hope to God we don't start asking people to pay for all this rescuing. And one comment to you, John Malos, you have changed your number underneath the Call Me in Live to put letters in. Would you please put that back into numbers? Because you have to, you know, it's hard enough to get into you as it is without having to figure out the letters and the numbers. But anyway, I just wanted to say thank you for all the great work that you guys do. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah, big thank you for what you guys do. It's a very dangerous job. It takes a lot of training. We're going to take a quick break here, come back with more with Greg and Jared from the Fresno County Search and Rescue Team. They do great things out there, and they put their lives on the line looking for those who are stranded, they're missing, they're injured, and in some cases, unfortunately, some people have perished, but they look for those bodies, and they have to do it. So, 436-ME-TV, option 11, back in just a moment.
The following is a list of celebrities you will not see on MeTV programs. Charlie Sheen, Lindsay Lohan, Snooki, Paris Hilton, Perez Hilton, Honey Boo Boo, Justin Bieber, Simon Cowell, Chris Brown, Miley Cyrus, and the Real Housewives of any place. This is who you will see on MeTV programs. Lucy, Ralph, Mary, Perry, Gilligan, Kenneth, Spock, Batman, Rowdy, Festus, and the Beaver. MeTV. Thanks for watching.
Have you or a loved one recently been arrested for a serious crime?
Is your professional reputation at risk?
Aggressive representation from a qualified defense attorney can help you avoid conviction and keep your reputation untarnished.
Hi, I'm Charles McGill, and I'll fight for your rights. With extensive experience in successfully defending against a wide range of criminal offenses and high-profile cases, you can rest assured that you'll get the fair trial you deserve from McGill Guzman McGill. Call us at 559-255-3425 or visit us online at toplawyersfresno.com.
Back here on the program, and for the young lady who called in, our number is 436-6388, and I know it is difficult to get in. You hit option 11. Sometimes, with the way the phone system is set up here, if someone is calling in, it throws you out, and you have to call back, and I know it's difficult. So 436-6388 is the number here. So I'm with two members of the Fresno County Search and Rescue Team, Jared McCormick there on the far right, and Greg Muskelin, who is a volunteer on the Mountaineers unit. And you were planning all of these search and rescuers, what, 180 of them last year when you guys were looking for this lost hiker. And so she survived, of course. There's no question she survived by some miracle. So how difficult a job was it? Tell us what you had to do to manage 180 searchers out there looking for one person. How difficult was it, and what did you have to do?
It becomes very difficult. You know, after usually about 3 days and we're not able to find her with our small team, it's not that small, we'll end up calling in through mutual aid from the state, and they'll send in other teams. We had 20 other agencies that participated in helping locate them. Mm-hmm. So they're sending bodies at you that we're calling for, but we need to make sure that we have a plan for where to send them in. So, I mean, we're breaking out maps, we're segmenting them, we're trying to figure out who needs to come out, who needs to go in, how to make sure that they always have the supplies that are necessary to stay viable out there. We're planning airdrops with food, insertions via helicopter to make sure people are going in and out. There's just a ton of logistics that needs to be looked into while back at the command post. So.
And you're having to deal with food, supplies, how to keep the crew happy and healthy and fit and ready to go, because, you know, fatigue starts to settle in even if you're in great shape.
Absolutely. It certainly
so
does.
So how do you keep 180?
Well, we're relying upon the information they send back to us via the radio. They may call in and say, hey, you know what, I've got an injured searcher that has an ankle sprain, and she's no longer able to go, or he's no longer able to continue on, and so we need to plan on how to get them out. And like this last search, it was 20 miles to get back into the area, so we can't just expect them to hike out. We need to work on contingency plans with the military to go in and get helicopters.
See, that photo right there is a great example of the rough fire and how difficult it was to work under those conditions with that heavy, thick smoke in trying to look for one hiker who survived for 9 days, Miyuki Hartwood. Look at the smoke.
Logistics here were an absolute nightmare because we did not have the options to use Air Force or helicopters all day long. It was just a short window, oftentimes from like 7 o'clock to 9 o'clock, where the smoke was down.
In the morning?
In the morning. Able to get them in and out. So our logistic opportunity was very difficult.
So it was like that most of the time, was it, Jared?
Yeah, it really was.
It was. And what did you, you were out there searching too.
Yes.
What did you do to protect your lungs from all that smoke there?
There really wasn't anything you could do.
A scarf? A mask?
Scarf wouldn't have helped much. It reduced the speed that we could hike. You fatigued much faster. So it slowed us down quite a bit, and that resulted in a need for more personnel to be in the field just because the smoke was so thick. It was hard at times. You just have to stop and take more rest because it was beating your lungs up.
Yeah, and maybe because of the smoke and the fire, maybe it did take extra time to locate her. I mean, that's reasonable, right? To assume that.
Yeah, I think that if we didn't have the smoke, we probably would have had a lot more air support. We could have got people in there faster, more people. We'd have had more eyes in the sky looking for her, but we just were limited by that. And given the remote location, 20 miles back, to have people hike that far just to get there, I mean, it's 2 days before they can even begin looking for her.
Yeah.
In an area we think she might be.
You mean just from where the command post was to getting to where she was a 2 day hike?
Yeah, 20 miles. There's no roads to go back there. These guys, like Greg and our volunteers who we rely heavy upon, you know, they're pounding the trails on foot 20 miles just to get back there.
That's amazing.
To start
so talk about your experience in having a hike in those kind of conditions.
Well, you're in a search scenario, so you're carrying a lot of equipment and extra food with you because you're going to be in the field for three or more days. So your pack is much heavier than you might want to carry. It was a very steep environment. The trails, so there were some of the areas had good trails, some areas it was very rough and rocky. And so you're on all fours crawling up and over boulders to try and cover your area. So it was a very difficult search.
All right, here's a stupid question, but I'm going to throw this out anyway. If I was one of the searchers and I had to hike for 2 days, I'll tell you one thing I'd be leery of and wouldn't want to confront, and that would be rattlesnakes. You ever come across rattlesnakes out there?
At that elevation, rattlesnakes would be very rare, but
really?
I have heard that it could happen. So rattlesnakes were kind of low on our list. It was more smoke that we were worried
about. Smoke. Any other animals that you were concerned with out there?
Not necessarily.
So you weren't packing heat, were you? Or you maybe? Well, you were, right?
You might not answer that question.
Yeah, okay.
We hang close to the
deputies. You were at the command center, so were you out there packing heat?
No, we rely on the deputies for that. But okay. It's a relatively it's a safe environment considering most people didn't want to be out there at that time.
Yeah, the rattlesnakes are a little bit lower than where she was. Because what elevation was Miyuki stuck at, I should say?
You know, I'm not positive, but I would guess maybe anywhere from 8,500 to 10,000.
So they're not going to go that high. Yeah, the rattlesnakes won't go that high.
Yeah, it's pretty cool.
Generally speaking, they won't.
Right.
They could have a rare occasion where they might. But so why do you do what you do? What's the gratification?
Well, as a volunteer, the people on our team, we have 65 people on the mountaineering team. They come from all walks of life, doctors, nurses, business people, and this is something that they have a passion for the outdoors. They have a skill set that.
But I'm talking about you. What's the gratification for you, Greg?
Being able to help somebody who's drastically in need. People who do this have a specific skill set, and they enjoy putting it to good use for somebody who needs that help.
And you, Jared?
It's right along the same lines. I mean, to be able to find somebody like we found Miyuki and knew that we saved her life, and it's very gratifying. And plus, you know, you get an opportunity to experience the great outdoors.
Mm-hmm.
The two go hand in hand, and it makes it just a fun assignment and very rewarding at the same time.
Yeah, and you know, the thing is, if we didn't have these search and rescue teams, many other people would be lost. Killed. Would you say that, and we've only got about a minute left, for those that want to go hiking, boating, skiing, whatever the case may be, up in the mountains, the mistakes that people make, are they usually avoidable?
Mistakes happen. I don't think you can get away from that. Just make sure you have an itinerary. You leave it behind with your family. Register with the Forest Service. Let them know your route that you're planning on taking.
Mm-hmm.
And take a buddy. Don't go alone. Use a map and compass. Take plenty of food and be prepared for storms. They might come in, so you need your clothing.
And so use some common sense, right, Greg?
Yeah, there are things that you can do, like Jared just clicked off, to minimize the chance that you're going to need to be rescued.
Yeah, just because you take all the precautions doesn't mean you won't get lost, you won't get hurt, you won't get injured, because you could slip off a rock, a cliff. You know, it can happen to anybody. But do the common sense things that you need to do to survive in case something happens. Am I right?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Jared, good to see you.
Thank you
for
having us.
Stay safe out there, and congratulations. You ought to be, you know, you ought to be highly congratulated for what you guys do, and we appreciate what you do, including Lieutenant Kathy Curtis here, who was here earlier. Appreciate your time.
You're welcome.
Thanks for all you do, guys.
Thank you. And I'd just like to thank all these volunteers, because they really are what makes it possible for us to get this accomplished, and we have a ton of them. And so we can always use more, and grateful for what they do.
All right. My thanks to the Fresno County Search and Rescue Team. We thank them for all they do. Tomorrow, Henry Perea is on. He's running for mayor. Back with the show tomorrow. Have a great day, everybody.
Have you or a loved one recently been arrested for a serious crime?
Is your professional reputation at risk?
Aggressive representation from a qualified defense attorney can help you avoid conviction and keep your reputation untarnished.
Hi, I'm Charles McGill, and I'll fight for your rights. With extensive experience in successfully defending against a wide range of criminal offenses and high-profile cases, you can rest assured that you'll get the fair trial you deserve from McGill, Guzman, McGill. Call us at 559-255-3425 or visit us online at toplawyersfresno.com.
When you're looking for KitchenAid innovation and quality, who has the answers, the selection, the